Hello everyone on 8dotsplus.com, this is Daniel here, and in today's tutorial I'm going to teach you how to create this little and funky animation. So let's take a look. Okay, so we can see we have a ribbon here warping around some rectangle revealing a text. Alright. And everything happens pretty quickly. Then our rectangle turns around and it appears to be the 8dots logo. It shrinks down and we can see the 8dots logo more clearly right here, and then it simply fades out. So the highlight of this tutorial is going to be creating this ribbon animation. You wouldn't believe me if I tell you that it was created using only 2 keyframes and 1 controller, but you should, because it was. I'm going to teach you how to link all of these ribbon parts to one controller to be able to very easily control the animation of this little thing. Alright, so let's get started. I'm going to delete whatever is in my project panel and start fresh. The first thing we're going to do is create a new composition, so simply click Ctrl N on our keyboard. I'm going to make the duration of my comp 10 seconds. And use 25 frames per second, 1280 by 720 resolution, and call this main. Alright, so inside of the main composition, I'm going to create a new solid. So Ctrl Y on my keyboard, make sure it is comp size and call it BG. Click OK. And to this solid, I'm going to add a fill effect. So in the effects and presets panel, I'm going to type fill and add a fill effect to my solid. Right now I have the fill color, which I'm going to change. Pick something soft that you like this, and we will change this color later, but just for now, let's use the fill effect. All right, let's create another solid and we will call it dots. Now in the effects and presets panel, I'm going to scroll down to find my transition tab, and they have an effect here which is called CC grid wipe. I'm going to add it to the dots solid and increase the completion of this effect. Alright, and right now you can see what's going on the screen. I'm going to increase the border to get this kind of look, and I like it. Now I'm going to make the dots a little smaller by increasing the completion. Now I want to make more dots on my screen, so I'm going to increase the tiles. Simply drag this number up. Alright, and now you have created your background. I'm going to animate it really quickly. Create keyframe for the completion at the beginning of your timeline. Move 20 frames forward using the shift and page down key. Now I'm going to click U on my keyboard with the dot selected, add another keyframe, and this will be our final state, or maybe a little bit bigger dots like this. Alright, and our starting state will be 0%. Alright, now I'm going to add fill effect to this solid as well. And we are going to make the color of these dots a little darker. So using this eyedropper tool, I'm going to select this color and now enter the color option and decrease the darkness like this. Alright, let's take a look at the animation. Here it is, revealing very beautifully just like this. I'm going to select the last keyframe and right click, go to keyframe assistance, easy is, and in the graph editor mode, now I'm going to shift this handle to the left and we have eased the motion. So let's take a look, and it comes to a gradual stop just like this. I'm going to select both of these layers and click Ctrl Shift C on my keyboard in order to pre-compose them, and I'm going to call this BG. All right. Now comes the fun part, and we are going to create our middle rectangle. So inside of my timeline panel, I'm going to right click, go new, and select shape layer. Now to this shape layer, I'm going to go add and add a rectangle. And I'm also going to add a fill. Now let's open the rectangle options. Let's make the rectangle 500 by 500 and increase the roundness to something like 30. Okay, so it's nice and round. Now let's open the fill, and under color we are going to pick some nice color to suit our whole composition. And you don't have to be precise with the colors right now because we are going to change all of them later. Just make something that looks nice for you right now. Okay, so that's our rectangle, and we are going to close this, and I'm going to rename this and call it main. Okay, so right here we have our rectangle, and we are going to create the lines that are going to warp around it. So let's create a new solid, Ctrl Y on the keyboard, and I'm going to call it line back one, because I want the lines to start warping around my rectangle from the back. Click OK. Now I'm going to shut the eyeball for this line, and using the rectangle mask tool, I'm going to draw a mask around this big, maybe a bit bigger, like this. Okay, and that will be my line, and I'm going to turn it back on. Now, since I want to start it warping around from this end, coming behind my rectangle, going like this, I want to move my anchor point right to this point. I'm going to use the reposition anchor point script, which can be found on ascripts.com. So simply select this little arrow and click reposition. Okay, if you don't have the script, you can of course use the pen behind tool, which can be accessed by the shortcut Y, and simply moving your anchor point to the desired position. Now with this line selected, I'm going to center it a little bit like this, and now I'm going to give it a little bit of rotation. So with the line selected, I'm going to click R and rotate it by 13 degrees, maybe a little bit less, maybe 12. Okay, I'm going to move it a little bit upwards and place my layer behind the main rectangle. I want to make my line a little bit prettier, so I'm going to zoom in right here, and with this line selected, I'm going to select the pen tool, clicking G, adding a point right here where the anchor point is, and just dragging it inwards like this. Let's zoom back out. So now I'm going to duplicate this line, Ctrl D, and I'm going to place it above my main rectangle. I'm going to delete this point I've just created. So again, choosing the pen tool, using G, going to delete it, and I'm going to rotate it to 0 degrees. So click R to select its rotation and simply type 0. Now we will have to change the position of the anchor point to the right side. And again, I'm going to use the reposition anchor point tool. And now let's place our line in the correct place. So simply move it down. I'm going to zoom in right here and place them perfectly. Like this. You can see they line up perfectly, and that's exactly what I want. Now I'm going to rename this solid, so select it and click Ctrl Shift Y, call it line 1. So we have line back 1 and line 1. Now I'm going to duplicate the line back 1, clicking Ctrl D, and I'm going to rename it to line back 2. Okay, again I'm going to delete this point, so with the pen tool just click on it, right, and I'm going to move it downwards using my arrow keys. Again, zoom in right here. And line them up just like this. I'm going to duplicate my front line again, so Ctrl D, move it downwards, line them up, and I'm going to cut this part of the recording and come back to you after I'm done duplicating my lines. Okay, so if you have used the settings I have, you should see something like this. I'm going to select my line back number 4 and go to the pen tool, add a point right here on the right side and drag it inwards like this. I'm just using the arrow keys. And right now you have your line warped around your rectangle. Now, since the lines are white, it is a little bit hard for us to tell them apart. We are going to take care of it soon, but first of all, in the timeline, I'm going to select my front lines and I'm going to give them, let's say, yellow color. Now let's select the back lines and give them pink color. And it will be easier for us to select the right layer in the timeline. Now I'm going to create a new null object, so Ctrl-Alt-Shift-Y on the keyboard, and with the new null object selected, I'm going to click Ctrl-Shift-Y and rename it to Control. Now I'm going to click OK and make my null invisible. Let's select all of the layers except from the background and the null object itself and parent them to the null. Now I can scale up and down my whole setup without having to do any further adjustments. And now I'm going to go to the effects and presets panel and type slider control. Now let's take this slider control, drag it and drop it onto our control layer. And I'm going to rename it to warp. Okay. Now let's select our first line from the back and click S on the keyboard. Right now we have revealed our scale property, and I want to add an expression to this property. So holding the Alt key, I'm going to click on this stopwatch right here. And now I'm able to add an expression. And what I'm going to do is simply type scale equals to and open rectangular brackets. And now I'm going to link my scale to the warp, just like this. So this is the X property of my scale, comma 100, and close rectangular brackets. Okay, so let's take a look what it means. When we scale our warp slider up, our first line appears. Let's solo it and take a look. But of course it's not enough, because as you can see, when we go beyond 100, something is messed up and our line is too long. We want it to stay on the exact size that we made it. We don't want it to be any longer, not even on 1 pixel. So we'll have to fix it, and I will show you how. So we would like to add another line to this expression. So let's simply create this little symbol and click enter to start another line. So in this new line, we are going to add an expression which starts with if, open brackets, and we are going to link our slider right here. So again, using the pick whip tool, pick it up, and we have it. If this value is smaller than 100, close brackets, then we are going to have open rectangular brackets, this value, comma 100. So that's for our scale. So it means if this value is smaller than 100, our scale is going to be this value, comma 100. Else, which means if it is not smaller than 100, we are going to have 100, comma 100. Close rectangular brackets. Let's click away, and our expression is good to go. Let's take a look. We want to animate it from 0, and we are going past 100, and our solid stays at its size. Alright, so that's the base for our further expressions. I'm going to copy this expression, Control C, and let's go to line number 1. I'm going to solo it as well, and let's reveal its scale property and add an expression to it, holding Alt and clicking on the stopwatch. So let's paste our expression right here, Control V, and let's adjust our value right here. So instead of typing 100, we're going to type 200. And let's take a look at what happens when we animate our controller. So we scale it down and we scale it up, and you can see that our ribbons do not line up. So we have to do another little adjustment. And right here you can see it says if this value is smaller than 100, then we're going to have this value. It simply means that if we have here 79, the scale of this solid is 79, and we don't want it because we want it to be 0 until this one reaches 100. So in order to do it, we're going to type right here minus 100. So if this value right here is smaller than 200, we are going to have this value, but minus 100. So that's cool, but now we have negative scale. But we are going to fix it using the opacity property. We are going to make it invisible until this layer reaches its 100% scale. So let's open the opacity property for our line, and I'm going to click Shift T to have both of these properties, and let's add an expression to it. And I'm going to type if, open brackets, and let's select our warp controller, okay, and let's type smaller than 100, close brackets, then 0, else 100. Okay, let's take a look. We have our solid right here animating from 0 to 100, and then comes our line. As you can see, it comes one after another, and it works great for us. So now that's the whole base for our expression work in this project. We are going to use this if and else conditioning on the other layers. I'm going to copy the expression which is added to the scale, go to line back number 2 and reveal its scale property. I'm going to solo it as well, and let's add an expression, holding Alt and clicking on the stopwatch. Let's add an expression, Ctrl V. Right here we will have to change it from smaller than 200 to smaller than 300, and right here instead of minus 100, minus 200. Let's copy the opacity and paste it onto this opacity. So Alt click on the stopwatch, paste the opacity, and instead of smaller than 100, we should make it smaller than 200. Okay, let's take a look at how it works. We animate it on, and the second line comes, then the third one, and just keep moving in this pattern. Let's do it again. I'm going to copy this scale, go to line number 2, reveal its scale, add an expression, paste, and again smaller than 400 and minus 300. Now go to its opacity, add an expression, and I'm going to copy its opacity and paste it here. And instead of smaller than 200, smaller than 300. Again, let's make sure it works. Oh, we have to solo it as well. So it comes right here. Perfect. Let's move on to line back number 3. Solo it. Select the scale property. And let's add an expression. I'm going to copy my recent scale expression from line number 2. Paste it on line back number 3. And again, instead of smaller than 400, smaller than 500, minus 300 is going to become minus 400. Copy the opacity expression as well. Paste it right here. And change the 300 to 400. Make sure it works. And it does. Now we have our front line number 3, and we are almost done. Select its scale property, again add an expression, copy the latest expression you've used for the scale, Control C, Control V here, gain up the values by 100, like this, do the same with the opacity. And now for the last layer, which is line back number 4, I'm going to click S, select this scale expression, paste it over here, and up the values. Do the same to the opacity. And that's really, really awesome, because now we can simply control our ribbon like this. Take a look how we simply scroll our controller and everything appears. Let's unsolo everything so we have our full scene. Take a look at the beautiful animation we are getting right here. Okay, and I'm really happy with the result. And we can move on. Let's do a little bit of coloring, and I'm going to use the color rules effect made by Digital Juice in the effect and presets panel. Type color rules and drag this effect to line back 1, and I'm going to select the fill option instead of the colorize. Let's go to scheme number 1, and I'm going to copy this effect, so Control C, paste it onto the other line layers. Now simply choose different colors. So for the back lines, we are going to use the first color. For the front lines, let's use another color, maybe a darker one. Maybe it should be the other way around. Okay, let's switch it. I'm going to select the bright here. Here I'm going to select the darker color. So now it is a little bit hard for us to see, but as soon as our background reveals, as it should, we can see everything pretty easily. Okay, and I'm going to click Ctrl S on my keyboard to save my current progress. So for now, I'm pretty happy with our result, and I want to animate our warping line for now. So create a keyframe for the warp slider after 1 second, and move, let's say, 2 seconds forward, maybe 3 seconds forward. We should see. Okay, click U and create another keyframe. So it should be on 700. At the first keyframe, it should be 0. So let's see how it animates. Okay, that's awesome. We can select both of these keyframes and ease them. So select them, go right click keyframe assistance, ease, enter the graph editor, and simply drag the handles a little bit inwards so we have nice acceleration effects like this. And now we would like to have text. Okay, how do we add text? So to add a text, of course, we have to use the text tool. So let's select text tool and type something like this. And my text is very little, so I'm going to scale it up. And I'm going to use the Typograph Pro font on the semi-bold italic option. Alright, let's scale it down. And now I would like my text to be exactly at the center of my line. So let's select the text. Place the anchor point exactly at the center of my text using the reposition anchor point script. And now with my text selected, click Ctrl Home, so now it is in the center of the comp. Now holding Shift on the keyboard and using the arrow keys, I'm going to drag it up, make sure it is in the center right here. So we have our first text. Let's duplicate it. Control D, move it down. Okay, and let's type is We can duplicate it and move it down. And awesome. So this is awesome. Let me type this like this. This like this, right? Okay. And we have our texts, and I'm going to add the color rules effect to them as well. So add the color rules, choose the fill option, go to scheme number one. You should be on number one, it's default option. And I'm going to select the force color and paste it to all of the others, like this. Now, if you don't know how to use the color rules effect, it's pretty easy. You simply add it to the layer and you have your digital juice color rules effects controller tab, which is right here. I place it right here. It can be accessed by going to window, and here you have it. Now you have a few coloring options like monotone, complement, and all of the others. So using these handles, you simply drag around and select colors. It is as simple as this, and using this wheel, you control the brightness of your colors. Okay, so that's how easy it is. And then you simply add your colors to the layers. Now, what I would like to see is my text appearing with my lines. I'm going to place my first text, which is this, above line number one, and duplicate line number one, Ctrl D, and I'm going to click F4 on my keyboard to toggle the switches. Now I'm going to place my text layer right under this duplicated line, and using the track matte modes, I'm going to select alpha matte. And let's take a look what happens. It reveals my text like this. Okay, so let's repeat this process, duplicate our second line, place our second text in between of those lines, and using the alpha matte option, we are going to reveal our text. Okay, do it again with the last text. Place your text in between those layers, alpha matte. Okay, and here we are revealing texts. Now, when I was working on this project, I wanted to have a composition which looks a little bit more clean than this. So what I did is pre-composed my text layers. So let's select the line and the text layer and click Ctrl Shift C and call it text 3. Okay, so I call it text 3, I pre-compose it. And now when I try taking a look, oh, it doesn't work. Why didn't it work? Let's go inside of this composition and take a look. Okay, the text doesn't change. Let's turn on our line. And we can see that our line scale doesn't change at all. Let's take a look at the problem. Select the line, click S. Let's take a look at the expression, and we can see that our expression was disabled. So the reason it was disabled is because the expression says this comp layer control and what follows. We don't have any control layer inside of this comp. Now that's a problem. So we have to link our scale property to the main comp. In order to do it, we are going to change the expression. I'm going to select this comp text, alright, type comp, make sure the comp is written with a small letter, open brackets and open parentheses, type main, close brackets and close parentheses and close brackets. Now I'm going to copy what I've written here, Ctrl C, and paste it wherever I see this comp. Alright, so I have it three times right here, Ctrl V, Ctrl C every time. And you can see that my scale effect works. But something else doesn't work. I can see my line which scales to this side. Take a look, it looks weird. Why does it happen? Because the opacity is not zero. So we have the same problem with the opacity property. Let's go ahead and fix it. Click T and open the expression. And we have this comp right here, and we're going to Control V to change it right here. It works. Let's take a look at our text. Here it is, scaling, 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 all right. And that's what we have to do with the other layers. So I'm going to pre-compose them. So select the second line and select its text, Control Shift C on the keyboard and type text 2, open this composition, click U to reveal the expressions, and wherever I see this comp, I'm going to click Control V after selecting this comp. Okay, go ahead and do it. So that's after solving the problem for the second text. Let's now go ahead and pre-compose the last one. So here it is. I'm going to select the text and the line. Control Shift C and type text 1. Enter this composition. Select the line and click U. Again, replace this comp with what we've copied before. And I will come back to you in a second. Okay, so back into our main composition, we can see everything animating just like it should, and it looks awesome. Now, while working on this, I noticed I had a little problem with my awesome tag. That's because I forgot to turn back off my line layer in the text number 3 composition. So it was turned on, and I had to turn it off by simply clicking on its eyeball. Okay, so that worked out, and I want to point out another problem I encountered while working on this project. You remember that we linked all of our lines to this control layer, right? So we can control the scaling. So let's take a look, scale it down, okay? And right away you can see that our text doesn't match, and really, it's not good for us. We want it to match, we don't go ahead, resize everything, reposition it, and a lot of work. We just don't want it. How are we going to fix it this time? Let's go ahead to our text compositions. So I enter the first text comp, and I'm going to add a new null object. So Ctrl Alt Shift Y on the keyboard and rename it, call this scale. So what I'm going to do is simply parent my line to this scale null object, and then I'm going to parent my scale null object to the control null object from my main comp. Let's go ahead and do it. Parent the line. Okay, that's done. Let's hold Alt and click on the stopwatch for the scale property of this null object. Alright, I'm going to move this comp right here to the side for a second, go back to my main comp, and select this expression right here using the Pick Whip tool, drag and select it. Okay, you can see that my text was scaled. Now I can bring it back right here, place the panels in the right place, and we have everything scaled properly. Now we are in composition text number 1. We have our null object, which is controlling the scale of this two layers. We can see both of them are linked. We're going to copy this null, Ctrl C, paste it into the second comp, click U, and I'm going to copy this expression, Ctrl C, delete it. So my scale is at 100%. Let's select these layers, parent them, and paste our expression again. So hold Alt and click, paste the expression. You can see that our text was scaled down. Do it again, copy the null, Ctrl C, paste it here. Let's select the expression and copy it. Now delete it. Select both of the layers and parent them to the null. Paste the expression back. Let's take a look. Now our effect is fully controllable, as you can see right here. Now I have to admit, when creating this project at first, I had encountered all of these problems and they just gave me a headache, and fixing them, it wasn't too hard, but it took a little bit of time, and I wanted to share this technique with you so you don't have to lose all of this time trying to figure out how to fix all of these problems. So after we have encountered all of these problems in the tutorial, we can say we've finished the tutorial. I taught you what I wanted, the technique I wanted to show you, but in the preview you saw something else, and I'm going to jump back to my original file. So here I am in my original file, and I just wanted to show you now real quick how I created this ending part when the ATAT's logo is revealed. So obviously the warping back of my ribbon was made using keyframes, of course. So you can see we had keyframes revealing everything, then it stays on its place and then goes back. Now before the ribbon has completely disappeared, you can see the main rectangle starts rotating just like this. So in order to rotate it, I made it 3D and I parented my logo to this square, and of course I added animation keyframes to this square, rotation keyframes. I also reduced the roundness, so you can see the ATAT's logo shouldn't have any round corners, so I dealt with it as well and simply scaled down the square. Okay, and then I just faded everything out. Now you can also notice that I have added drop shadow to all of these components to make them more visible. Of course you can go ahead and do the same in your project. So basically go ahead and add drop shadow to your layers. You can see I added drop shadow, set the direction to 180 degrees, opacity on 50%, distance on 5 pixels and softness 13 pixels, and I just readjusted my settings to each layer according to my needs. And you can see I have here a hue layer, which is an adjustment layer. You can see what happens when I delete it. We are using the same color scheme as we did in the project right now, and I wanted everything to be in the 8-dots color, so I simply added a hue and saturation effect and played a little bit with the master hue wheel to get this color. And basically that's all you have to know for this tutorial. I hope that you learned something from it. I hope that this whole problem and encountering scenes were helpful for you. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate and ask me in the comments. Leave any comment you would like and please rate the tutorial. Take a look at my other tutorials on ATATSplus.com. I hope they can benefit you in many ways. Take a look at my projects over videohelp.net, and I will see you next time.